Just as we started to roll, he walked.
Oh, yeah. He walked away.
I'm
looking for a vintage microphone to pull out and pretend to use.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Mulligan Stu, CKUA Radio. I'm Terry David Mulligan. From the top left-hand corner, with possibly the worst green screen background I have ever seen, Simon Kendall.
Oh, hi. Green screen. This is hiding good treasure.
And where exactly are you?
I'm in my Hammond Avenue studio in East Vancouver.
Okay. I thought you were in Brazil or something.
Oh, well, recently I was in Lunenburg and I made a little pilgrimage to the Neptune Theater in Halifax, where I got to be Terry's boss many, many years ago. 32 years ago, I was the music. Yeah, okay, fine. Look at your watch. I was in Halifax for a wedding. It was wonderful. And we went down to Lunenburg, and that's where I was. Not Brazil, but Lunenburg.
Nice. And the real reason why we're here, of course, Teresa Alfeld, who's the director, and they're both in the movie, Doug and the Slugs and Me. You are the me. Bring me up to speed, please. Because I'm in the movie and still to this day on the house that we sold in Nanoose Bay, my marks are still stenciled on the deck.
I'll leave them
there so that we can tell that story. Right there is what we shot. By the way, it was the best shot of all of your shots. It was gorgeous. Oh, thank you.
Bring me up to speed.
Thank you. Bring me up to speed on what's been happening. You went to Toronto, you debuted. What happened?
Yeah. So, first off, thanks so much for having me. It's so nice to see you again, Terry. I agree. It's the best looking interview in the entire film. I mean, Simon Kendall, close second, but I think hats off to Terry's shot. So we actually premiered the film back in the spring at Doxa Documentary Film Festival. We were the closing night gala film. We had a big event there. I don't know, Simon, was it a big event?
It was a big event. Full pull, all Slugs.
Yeah.
Caracus.
Yeah.
And full house.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And all the Bennett family. So I'd have to say that was a thrill to get everybody together to see the film for the first time and have all our adoring Vancouver fans to ask penetrating questions.
How penetrating? What was the most penetrating?
What was the worst gig you guys have ever done? And we all agreed. But we won't go into that.
Okay.
And so fast forward to this past weekend, we brought the film to Toronto. We had our Toronto premiere at the Hot Docs Ted Rogers Cinema, which was a really lovely reunion of a number of folks who hadn't been present for the Vancouver screening. Yeah. And then the following day on Sunday night at 9 p.m., we made our broadcast debut on CBC Documentary Channel. We have a number of broadcasts lined up on that channel before we will make our CBC main channel premiere and Gem premiere. I don't think I'm allowed to say when, but those are in the cards. And
give us at least a month.
It will be in the new year. Early in the new year, we'll be dropping on main channel and Gem, and so we can't wait to share the film with a wider audience.
Okay, tell me if I'll edit this stuff out if I go too far in some areas. Simon, did CBC want anything to do with you when you were Doug and the Slugs?
Oh yes.
Did they like you?
I would say CBC was quite supportive. Yeah, we had some live broadcasts. I remember one event. Well, this was a wacky event, but at the time. She'll kill me. Vicky Gabbro had a radio show.
Yes.
And she was based in Toronto.
Yes.
And her late husband, Tom Rowe, had put out possibly the worst recording ever, which was Bruce and the Smoking Donkeys, which the only caveat was if you played an instrument, you couldn't play it in the recording.
Okay.
And we were debuting it on Vicky's show. So, you know, that's very supportive. And we kind of played 20 seconds of it and then... took it off the turntable. We were all there in Toronto at Vicky's studio.
Teresa, you're puzzled. You have a puzzled look on your face.
This is news to me. This is, again, I did my best to get in depth in the slug history and research, but Simon Kendall never ceases to surprise me with new delightful tidbits of slug history and such.
I know deep into the publicity for this film, and you were going to always do publicity, and I was always going to be waiting at the pass. I'll get you, Teresa, to fill in how you became connected with this story. Give me the Reader's Digest version, and then Simon, we're going to go to a little background on Doug and the Slugs for a generation that wasn't even around.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Teresa, over to you.
Yeah. The film really started off, I would say, about 4 years ago. I made my first feature documentary with my producer, John Bolton, the rank and file Legacy of a Radical, and we were looking for a soundtrack. We were looking for some music that really captured an energetic Expo era 1980s Vancouver. And it wasn't hard to think, I happen to know a band that checks that box. And so I connected with Simon. We ended up licensing a number of tracks. In fact, all the music in my first feature is Doug and the Slugs. And we knew that audiences would love it, but we weren't quite prepared for how large the response was to the soundtrack. You know, we got lots of great press on the film, wonderful audience reception, but people kept talking about, and the Doug and the Slug soundtrack. At one point we brought Simon to one of our screenings, and bloody hell, he got a standing O. And we thought, okay, I think we might be onto something here. There's an incredible Vancouver band with an incredible story. This is a documentary that, you know, in our stupidity, we think is going to be pretty simple to make. Let's just get everyone together, fundraise some money, and we'll have it done in a year.
Knock it off.
Knock it off that way. So that was the beginning. Of course, that's not exactly the direction things took.
Yes. It was a chore, wasn't it, finding the story. Now, the storyline, Simon, Doug and the Slugs' place in Canadian music, without getting too far gone with the superlatives, let's just tell the story.
Well, we formed in 1978 in Vancouver. Doug was a transplant from the Danforth, from Eastern Toronto. He'd been out here working at the Georgia Strait with some luminaries, including Bob Geldof.
He was a clever and talented cookie in that area. He was really good.
Yes. And four of the Slugs had been in and out of different bands. We met in high school at Lord Byng High on the west side of Vancouver. And I had defected to the country. I was living life out in Rossland, and I got a phone call saying, we're putting a new edition of the band together, and you need to be here. So I threw my Fender Rhodes in the truck and drove down and played a gig, and we started. So we were I would say, local underground phenomenon in 1979. We were selling out all the rooms we played. It had taken us over a year to get booked in any of these rooms. We had no management deal, no recording deal. Everybody was a little gun shy about booking us managing us. Yeah. Because they thought, well, this is a novelty act and it won't translate to vinyl, et cetera, et cetera. So lo and behold, our other high school buddy, Sam Feldman, approached us, and he was interested because he noticed how we were selling out all these clubs. And he thought, yeah, these guys are onto something. And so we signed we handshook a management deal with Sam Feldman, we being Doug. And great, everything's in place. And then Sam thought he would send us out to Toronto on the Ball Breaker tour in 1979, late 79, to get our asses kicked, because he figured, well, you know, this is all very well in this little lower mainland enclave.
Might as well find out what the lay of the land is.
And there we were playing these really quite nasty gigs, sleeping on people's floors, ruining borrowed vehicles, flying on red eyes, etc. And during that time, the independent single that we had recorded in Vancouver, Too Bad, blew up. And so there we were on the worst possible tour with a single that was climbing the charts. We were ecstatic. And we came back and we got to feed Drew Burns at the Commodore. some considerable crow because he had sworn that no band named Doug and the Slugs would ever play the Commodore. And we sold it out, first time of, I believe, over 40 sellouts at the Commodore. And we had suddenly a national phenomenon with the Slugs and started touring relentlessly over this vast country and finding fans all over it.
Well,
is that Reader's Digest enough for you?
I'm your editor. Teresa, one of the things you had working for you, and I'm just going to, I'm a nominated committee for the Critics Association, and there's over 300 documentaries to see. So it's a great time to be a documentary in this day and age, but some of them have to recreate the entire story.
Yeah.
Because there's no footage. You had footage. You had lots of footage. You just had to find narrations in between that footage, yes?
We really lucked out. Once Simon and my producer John and I had realized there was a film to be made and we had the band's participation, one of the first things I did was I reconnected with Doug Bennett's widow. And Simon and I went over to her condo in downtown Vancouver, had a wonderful reunion, and she took me down to her storage locker. And I think I was speechless for maybe a full minute as I look at banker box upon banker box upon banker box labeled VHS broadcast recordings, 3/4 inch broadcast masters, 35 mil outtakes from Making It Work video, photos, fan mail. It was just, it was like hitting the jackpot. It was absolutely incredible. This has happened to me very few times in my career that I get to walk into an archive and have an archive master trust me with all the pieces. So Simon and myself, and I think Devin and her boyfriend, Devin, Doug's daughter, and her then boyfriend, all loaded it into the car. We took it to my home office and just started going through this absolutely incredible collection of really never before seen footage in many cases.
But at the same time, when did you discover that you were linked, that you would be part of this story as well?
I'm still dealing with that part and figuring that part out. You know, it was certainly, you know, as I said, when we first connected with Simon and we realized how strong the Slugs following was and how huge an appetite there was to hear the music and to find out the story, I thought, great, we're going to do a fantastic rock documentary. It's the rise and fall of the band. It'll be really short. We'll make it really quickly. But sort of as we started going, I had to sort of acknowledge, I guess, that I did have a personal connection to the Bennett family. So part of the story in the film, as well as in my life, was I grew up beside Doug Bennett. I moved next door to his house when I was 5 years old. I was instant best friends with his daughter. I grew up in his house. And as a, you know, foolish little kid, I had no clue who Doug Bennett was and who Doug and the Slugs were. This was, you know.
Few did.
Pardon me?
Few did.
Well, I wouldn't go that far, but, you know, suffice to say the mid to late 90s, you know, Simon wasn't as much connected to the band. Things were a bit more in a smaller place than they had been, say, in the early 1980s. So I had grown up with this connection to the family, this close relationship to all the individuals. I'd lost touch with them in high school. But as I started researching the story, I mean, one of the first things that happened was getting home movies of the Bennett household and seeing myself in them.
Yeah.
And realizing that, you know, there might be an interesting angle to not shy away from, including how our lives were interwoven, as much as I wanted to avoid it. I promise this was not easy to have to negotiate that.
So from my point of view, I'll just interject here, Terry, you know, we having gone through the first licensing experience with Teresa, where I said, well, you know, it's possible we can work this out, but I'll have to talk to the Bennett family. And she said, oh, I've already talked to them. And that's never happened in the years of licensing our music to films. So I thought, oh, interesting. And then I learned about Teresa's history. And because I'm just another self-absorbed musician, I assumed, of course, Teresa would know all about the band because she lived next door to them. And then in the course of the first interviews we did with Teresa, we realized she really knew nothing about the band. She just knew Doug's daughter. So she had a pretty steep learning curve to learn about all the quirks and grumpy slugs that were, you know, hiding in the woodwork.
A lot of quirks. A lot of quirks, my friend. A lot of quirks.
Kudos to Simon for being patient with me. I think I remember our very first pre-interview sitting in your studio where you are now, and your temple kind of throbbing a little bit, thinking, oh God, what have I gotten myself into? This young woman knows literally nothing. Luckily, I would like to say over the course of 4 years, I've managed to research and digest a sufficient amount to make the film. But again, kudos to Simon for his enduring patience.
Professor Kendall, let me ask you about who today, making music today, can trace their lineage back to some of the influences of Doug and the Slugs?
Well, I was quite chuffed, as the Brits would say, to see that Teresa had connected with Ron Sexsmith and Stephen Page. In particular, they have cameos in the extensive cameos in the film. And I was really happy because in the 90s, lots of music friends said, the BareNaked Ladies really owe you guys. But
yeah,
guess what? We were pretty much gone by then. And we thought, well, yeah, and they've taken it a step further and good for them, etc. But to hear Stephen Page acknowledge the debt that their band has to our band is really, you know, it's wonderful. And exactly who, I mean, John Bolton, Teresa's producer, joked that, you know, try as they might, they couldn't find anybody in Canada to slag our band. And I said, well, I can make a few suggestions if you really want, but, you know, they didn't take me up on my offer. So honestly, there is a surprising and extensive positive response to the band.
Well, listen to the, I mean, look at the tunes, Making It Work, Too Bad, Day by Day, Tomcat Prowl, David Go-Go, just down the road in Nanaimo, did a great shuffle version.
I played on David's version.
Yes, he did.
I played what the other guy did, but you know.
Love whatever. Shines. it's got to be Monday. I mean, on and on and on. A bag of songs that stood the test of time. They still play well. I still play them. I know.
Thank you.
Demanding of the songs. I try, if I'm going to play classic rock of any type, they have to hold up. The songs have to hold up. They can't be cheesy. This is great. By the way, while I'm at it, of Making It Work, Too Bad, and Day by Day, which has the most plays on Spotify?
Well, I haven't done my research, but I suspect you have. I would guess Making It Work.
Teresa?
Oh, I would guess Making It Work as well.
Day by Day.
Oh!
Well, I'm very...
The song wants to come back. That song wants to come back, okay? I'm just saying. Just saying.
Well, thank you for doing the research and informing me that I'm wrong, because Day by Day, I will say that since we released the song, we've had an incredible, very personal, very powerful endorsement of the song and what it's meant to a vast array of people in their lives. And that's, I think, very fitting, because Doug wrote the song when his dad died, and it's anthemic, it's positive, and I think that that alone means that it has helped countless people, and we're very grateful to have been part of that.
Mm-hmm. Teresa, did you find the answer to the question, the big question? No, this one in particular. Was it alcohol that killed Doug? What took him from us?
Yeah, so when Doug passed away in 2004, and I might let Simon speak to this a bit more, but my understanding was it didn't feel like the right time, and there weren't anyone who was really willing to put voice to what exactly had transpired and caused Doug's death. Simon fielded a lot of the media requests, I believe, as the family wasn't prepared to do so. And the term that was used with conversation agreement was a longstanding illness. In my experience of researching the film, it's been, you know, going on 20 years since Doug's died. And it's only now, I think, that people are much more comfortable discussing Doug's manner of death. So yes, it was complications from long-term alcohol abuse that took his life. And what's been really, I've found to be, and I hope that his family and friends and loved ones feel the same, is that there's much less stigma when discussing alcohol abuse and alcohol addiction now than there was, say, in the early 2000s or even in the 90s when Doug's problems started progressing. So it was much easier to have these conversations with the surviving family and friends and loved ones now. And then, of course, to have someone like Sir Bob Geldof weigh in, who, of course, has quite a bit of personal experience losing loved ones to substance abuse. I was really heartened to see that the needle had really moved on how we are able to talk about alcohol and substance use as an illness, not as a character flaw.
Simon?
All of what Teresa said, I was conflicted at the time. If it had been my responsibility or my right, I would have used the example as a cautionary tale at the time. Mm-hmm. But I felt that it was really not my place, even though I'd been in a band with him for 20 years or whatever it was at the time. And so I'm very, I mean, I think it's the right move that we have told the true story. Doug was a heavy drinker from the minute, you know, the day I met him. He was incredibly functional. Never saw him impaired or anything, but he drank a lot of alcohol, and it finally caught up with him. And I believe it's most accurate, as Teresa has said, to say that it was complications from alcoholism that took him away. And I think that it's an important lesson, and one that people should be aware of.
I'm thinking about, I get nostalgic about this, of course, and it pulls at me. Today, were he with us, he would be scoring films. He would be literally totally immersed in the world of putting music into moving pictures. Mm-hmm. I believe that was where it may be headed, but we'll never know. Now, what's the life of the now that you've kicked off and you've done the best in Toronto, what now? And it's going to roll out. We'll see it. Mm-hmm. Then do you take it stateside? What do you do with it?
So right now, our Canadian release plan is, again, we are now available on CBC Documentary Channel. Yeah. And we will be going to CBC Main Channel and Gem. I'll say the date, and I'll check with CBC if I'm allowed to. But on January 15th, we'll be making our big broadcast premiere on CBC Main Channel and CBC Gem. We are still exploring American rights as well as international rights, so we're hoping to be able to bring the film to those markets in the new year.
I thought it was interesting. It was a comment from an old friend of mine who came to the screening in Toronto, and he said it is so different to see this film. He'd already watched it online. He just said it's so different to see it in a theater. Mm-hmm. And another question that came up in the Q&A in Toronto was that people said, you know, are you taking this internationally because it's a story that is beyond the, you know, more than just the band? And I thought, well, I have no idea what kind of interest there would be. I think the film is strong enough and enough layers that you don't have to be a fan of the band to learn and appreciate what's in the film, learn from what's in the film. So.
And a recent conversation about reforming the band, where are we with that?
Well, 13 lucky years ago, we had the idea. John Burton called me up and said, you know, so I've seen this guy who reminds me of Doug. And I said, well, it seems impossible. I had been approached, just backtracking, within weeks of Doug's death. Somebody called me. I actually can't remember, so I won't protect their identity because I can't remember. But somebody called me from Ontario saying, hey, get the band together. Find a guy. Now's the time. And I went, really, that's pretty tacky. And forget it. I was quite dismissive. 5 years later, John called me and said, what did I think? And I said, well, if all the five surviving original members are available and interested, and the family's on side, and we can find somebody to do justice to the material, let's give it a shot. That's what we did. We auditioned three guys. Ted Okus came in. He was the third guy. And we just got goosebumps. It was unbelievable. And so we haven't been touring extensively, but we've been playing ever since with the five guys who made the records and Ted singing. And we get a very positive response. People love the music and they thank us for keeping it alive. So we're still touring.
Somebody's going to have to mortgage their house.
yeah.
Teresa, you have a, while you went through this, because you didn't just shoot a documentary, you lived it. Mm-hmm. It pulled at your heart, I know. Now that you've done this exercise, did something present itself, another story present itself to you? Do you have a second film to make quickly?
As in what is my next project? So, I mean, just before I answer that question, I just want to state how fantastic the current iteration of Doug and the Slugs is with Ted Okus. I've had the pleasure of seeing the guys play a number of times. My favorite concert being the 40th anniversary show at the Commodore, which was instant out. The floor was shaking. I mean, I know it's the special bouncy floor, but it was literally shaking. And Ted just does such a beautiful tribute to the music. All the guys play so well. Everyone sounds fantastic. And I couldn't be happier that, you know, they're keeping the music alive, and it's phenomenal. To gracefully segue to what I'm doing next, it's completely different. I can't talk a lot about it, but I can tell you that it is a documentary about the intersection between science fiction and assistive technology, and two big dorks who are on a crusade to come up with some really radical ways to improve the lives of people with physical disabilities.
So you're working with Simon again?
I assume Simon will be scoring it. So we'll be talking about that after.
Sorry, I just had to take the shot. I'm sorry.
Yeah, I know you do. Yeah, what can I say? Well, she's got so much material. The other side of that is, you know, honestly, there's easily a mini series in, you know, that didn't make the screen. So perhaps, you know, when Teresa's really desperate, she'll get into the weeds and she'll find some of those outtakes that we think would be exciting for the hardcore thousands of Slug fans who want to see more.
Because you needed Doug. You needed Doug on screen. You needed to hear his voice, see his character. Were there some tapes that just disappeared that you never found? People told you about interviews that they had done, and did you find them all?
Honestly, interviews with Doug was probably the thinnest or the fewest of the different archival elements I was able to find. There was actually very little in the Bennett archive. The main interview that we lean on was a sort of behind the scenes piece that was done for a broadcast special, Caught in the Act, in 82 at a UBC. So there actually wasn't a ton of Doug Bennett interviews, but the biggest way we were able to bring Doug's voice into the story was through Doug's journals. Early in the process, Doug's widow, Nancy, handed over a large collection of Doug's personal journals, which he wrote from 1980 to 1989 while he was building the band. And rather than sort of sweat the fact that I couldn't find many interviews with Doug and couldn't find other ways to bring his perspective and voice, instead we brought the journals into the film, and we invited people who were close to Doug, Simon included, to read passages and reflect on Doug's version of events.
I know that I got an invite to go to their house downstairs, because it was a belting out a song night, standards. Yeah, I think it was like either Broadway or just song standards, Sinatra type songs with bass and things, but bring your loudest and biggest song and sing it into a microphone. I think it was recorded and I think it was videotaped, but were you there? Do you remember that?
No. For some reason, I wasn't invited. Maybe I was touring with somebody else. I don't know. You do get a cameo, though. I see you in the in Semlin. So
I think it was the Lounge Lizard Party in 1991. You were both there. They had set, so this wasn't the basement. So Simon or Terry, this might have been a different event, but Doug had set up a microphone. He had a band playing and everyone was invited up to sing. And you were most certainly there, Terry. You did the number is escaping me, but both of you were there and it looked like an
epic. Might have been Making Whoopee. I love that song.
Yeah. I love classic.
That. Well, I guess that's Terry pitching for, you know, the miniseries so that we can see Terry making Whoopee in the Semlin Drive. Yeah.
You know, when I sat and you interviewed me, I kept thinking, because now that I'm producing and editing, I knew the chore ahead of you. You were going to have a lot of elements here, and you pulled it together beautifully. It took a long time. You had the story that literally presented itself to you, what you would include and what you didn't. Would you go to guys like Simon who knew the story and say, does this work? Did you work by yourself in a hermetic room?
I guess I'll answer that question. Okay. Where Teresa was very clear at the outset that this was not our film. It was her film.
Yeah.
And because of her skill at interviewing and because of seeing the rank and file, our trust was very high in Teresa. It's a different story from what the band might have told, but I understand actually firsthand what it takes to make a film. I made a documentary film about tree planting, you know, 50 years ago, and I've been involved in scoring films. I know it's an arduous and incredibly consuming prospect to make a film. So we basically backed away. I asked about seeing a script and Teresa said no. And I said, okay. And we did not see it until pretty far along in the editing process. I will say that I think the editing is phenomenal. The attention to detail, the layers, tying the layers in together, I think is remarkable. And we gave some input and some of it, I think Teresa actually heard and responded to, which is great. It's a collaborative process, but we were kind of kept at arm's length, which I understand and appreciate.
She was on a mission.
Mm-hmm.
She was on a mission. Now, how do people, Simon, what's your best social contact for people who want to get a hold of you?
DougandtheSlugs.ca or Doug and the Slugs on Facebook. If they want me personally, Simon Kendall Music is a page on Facebook and they can message me there or my personal page, Simon Kendall. But DougandtheSlugs.ca has all the information about the band, upcoming gigs, and access to our fully remastered catalog, which has been my pandemic project.
I saw that. Everything's remastered. Everything.
Yep. And, you know, so that's maybe why Day by Day is blowing up on Spotify, because now for the first time ever, people can get everything. And in the near future, and I'm not going to put a date on it, we will be releasing some hidden gems, some obscure stuff that we've come across in our excavation of the archive, which, despite what Teresa said earlier, that archive was a mess. It might have been labeled, but my goodness, it was a, you know, it was a real slug burrow and it was not in good working order. And we've been digging our way through it ever since.
Are you saying it's from the Vault of Treasured Music on $1 Million Weekend? Is that what you're saying?
Well, more or less, yeah.
Okay. And Teresa Alfeld, what of you? How do we stay in touch with you?
So so for the film, our website is slugumentary.com. Wonderful name to have to repeat over and over again to the bank and our funders. So you can get screening updates on slugumentary.com. You can read our press reviews, watch trailers and excerpts, and keep up to date with what's going on. We also have a social media presence. You can follow us at Slugumentary. So that's documentary, but replace the word doc with slug for similar updates and announcements that way.
I want a slug t-shirt. I want to get in on the merch.
Well, come down to Sydney on the 21st of October, the Mary Winspear, and you know, we'll sign a t-shirt for you, Terry. We've got some new ones. Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.